standing and honoring the word of God and the Lord of the word. In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was and is God. We have in our hands the immaculate, inerrant, infallible, holy word of God, which stands forever, and we believe it. Reading from 2 Peter 2:15, please. 2 Peter 2:15. Which have forsaken the right way and are gone astray, following the way of Balaam, the son of Beor, and who loved the wages of unrighteousness. Father God, we ask that you illuminate your word and illuminate our hearts to receive the engrafted word, as we expect that this word will be planted and will bring forth much fruit, all to your glory. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen. You may be seated. If somebody forsakes the right way, two things we are taught. Number one, there is a right way, and that we are, believers, are in the right way. And since some can forsake the way, do you remember the exhortation of the word of God? He who confesses his sin and forsakes it, he is the one who is going to be blessed, makarios. He is the one who is going to be fruitful, who forsakes, he leaves behind his sin. But some will forsake the right way, meaning they were in the right way. So that's a warning to us who are in the right way. And I pray that you that are here and you that are watching in our church in Rhodes also, we are in the right way. And there is only one way. His name is the Lord Jesus Christ. He said, and nobody else said, he's the unique one. He is exclusive, the one who exclusively is our Savior. So if we are exclusive, we are not all-inclusive. Salvation is only through the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the way, he's the life, the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except through him. He is God who came into flesh to replace me in the vicarious death of Jesus Christ, my Lord, my Savior. He replaced me, and thus he took my place to make a way to the Father. Praise the Lord. He is the way. Do not forsake the way. Let's forsake our sins, but not the way. Let's stay in the way, and the way is the Lord Jesus Christ. The church in the book of Acts was called the way because they followed the way. So if they were in the church is the way, meaning what does it mean? Jesus Christ is his church. I don't believe, you know, in the beginning I heard from other speakers, other teachers, and sometimes we take it without being Bereans, like Sister Beverly said to me many times. And I encourage you, be a Berean, Bereos, not from Berea, not necessarily from the city of Berea, but the Bereans not only listen to the word of the Apostle Paul, but right after they search the scriptures to see if it was so. So I encourage you, search the scriptures. Why you're safe in the church? Why? Because it's the way. Yes, Because it's Jesus. Amen? He is his church. Let me remind you something. When two are married, that's divine revelation I'm moving into. When two are married, the Bible says the two shall become one. When somebody cleaves to the Lord, 1 Corinthians 6:17, when somebody cleaves to the Lord, and up to the 20, you'll see that we can praise the Lord with our spirit and with our bodies, which are the Lord's, in verse 20. We belong. We are the Lord's. Apostrophe, meaning that's possessive. Meaning we belong to him. Possessive. We are possessed by the Holy Ghost. Not by the devil, not by the world, not by the system of the world, but by the Lord and his word and his spirit. So the two can become one, right? In marriage, the two can become one in prayer, you and the Lord. If you cleave to the Lord, you are one spirit. So the Lord takes you, moves in you. Can he move in you? Can he move in me? Didn't he say in 2 Corinthians 6:14-17, this portion of scripture that exclusively speaks about separation and consecration, what light hath Christ with Belial? Light with darkness, the believer with the unbeliever. Come out, and I will be a father to you. I will move in you, walk in you, and move in you. Will he not do that? And he said, I will be a father to you, saith the Lord God Almighty. He is my father. He takes me. He moves through me. And then he says, thus saith the Lord of hosts. He says, hallelujah. They may see you, but behind you, in fact, before you, in front of you, hallelujah, before you, the Lord moves. Amen. And his hosts, hallelujah. David said to Goliath, you're coming in your own power, in your own strength, but I come in the strength of the Lord God of the host, Yehovah Tzevaot, which means the Lord of the armies. Amen. Revelation 19:11-16, the church is coming, by the Lord is coming to in the second coming, the Phtera Parousia, he's coming with his church. Amen. And his hosts, the angels, hallelujah. So is he going to use us then? Then he can use us now. If we move back and see the salvation of the Lord. Wow. They will not see me. May they may see Jesus the Lord in me and through me. Saith the Lord of hosts. It means the Lord with whom I have a covenant. If they cut a covenant, you know, they cut their wrists and they united the blood. And it means whatever I have available is available to you. And whatever you have available is available to me. How much do we have to give to the Lord? How much? Just ourselves. Just our hearts. Yes, and even our bodies. The body is not for sin. And the flesh, the desires of the flesh, the body is for the Lord. And the Lord is for the body. And if you cleave to the Lord, you are one spirit. Give your body to the Lord and you become the temple of the Holy Spirit. Give your body to the Lord and you're one spirit. It means you silence your spirit and he speaks through his spirit. He and us, we are one in covenant. So we make ourselves available. What do we give him? Just our body, just our heart, just our mind, just ourselves. And then he comes with all of his hosts as if he alone was not enough. But the, you know, God likes to show off his power if we humble ourselves. Amen. I believe in the power of God. I believe in signs and wonders, even now. I believe as the word is being preached, signs and wonders are taking place. And if they're not taking place in your life, they're taking place in my life. That's what you say, right? With me. Don't mind if somebody else doesn't receive. Say, if nobody is receiving signs and wonders, I'm receiving them right now. Brothers and sisters, I'm talking out of experience. It's happening all over me right now. I know it. It's not something I guess or speculate. It's something I know about. The Lord is right here, mightily moving amongst us, as if he and us, we are one, and we are one. So Jehovah Tzevaot, saith the Lord of hosts, means he makes all of his armies available. That's why little David didn't see huge Goliath. He saw the Lord. He knew the Lord is faithful. If you are not faithful, yet he remaineth faithful. Can he remain faithful? It's his nature to remain faithful. It's his name, faithful. So David put his faith in the Lord, took the stones from the river, word, waters, life, take the word and throw them against the enemy and hit the enemy, hit the target by saying, I come to you by the word of God and by the Lord of hosts. He knew, like Elisha prayed for his servant, I pray when the Syrians came and filled Samaria and there was an imminent defeat of the Israeli armies, then Elisha said, oh Lord, open my servant's eyes to see, because he was seeing. Maybe he was not seeing naturally because he was seeing spiritually, but his servant saw. We know he saw physically because his eyes were opened, the Bible says, and he saw the armies of the Lord. If we only saw today the armies of the Lord, we wouldn't even allow a trace of fear to be in our lives. He's not just babbling words. We are doing that. Every word he says, he honors it. Do you believe it? Are you covered by his covenant? Did you cut a covenant with the Lord? That happened on the cross. I received the blood of Jesus Christ. So all of his armies are available to us.
Amen.
That's an introduction. That's a revelation. Can the two become one? Yes. So when I say they called the church the way, why? Because Jesus is the way. But they called the church the way. Because Jesus and his church, it's the lamb and the bride, and they're getting married. We are the bride. He's the bridegroom. And the two shall become one. But we're already betrothed unto him. I've espoused you. 2 Corinthians 11. I have espoused you with one man, the Lord Jesus Christ, iravonisemas. And the Greek word means, I gave you a down payment. How many of you know that if he gives us the down payment, hallelujah, full payment is coming.
Yes, hallelujah.
He is not like us that we give sometimes. No, not me, not my family, not our church. All of payments are done. We owe and nothing to anybody. The church is, you know, we pay the rent on time, bills on time. Our cards have a standing order to be paid on time. Everything is paid. We have no, we don't owe anybody anything else but to love you. Amen. So we are supposed to be like him. So the church, I heard, was born on the day of Pentecost. Then I heard, and it makes sense, but we can trace back the birth of the church going a little bit farther in time and see that he blew on them. John 20, the Lord Jesus blew. Asto Maresi. Hallelujah. Trying to connect with the live broadcasting. Amen. Praise the Lord. So the church, some people say, was born when the Lord Jesus breathed upon his disciples and they received the Holy Ghost. In fact, they didn't speak in tongues then, but they received the Holy Spirit in them. They moved from the Old Testament to the New Testament when the Spirit of the Lord was on people, on certain very few elect people. Now it's in every believer. But yet we should go back and we go to the cross. I believe the church, and it's biblical. I support it by scripture, and you can be a Berean and support it with scripture too. And I believe the Lord Jesus Christ gave birth to his church when they speared him in his side and blood and water gushed out. Amen? That's the church of the living God. Didn't he say that no one can enter the kingdom of God except if he's born by water, the water and the spirit, the word and the spirit, the blood, the water, the word and the blood. And three are those that bear witness in the earth. 1 John 5:8. It's the blood, it's the waters, it's the spirit. So I believe this is the imagery of God Elohim in Genesis 1:27 when he said, let us make man after our image and likeness. So it was the first operation ever, and God put Adam to sleep, and out of his side he cut him, and out of his side to Gerib and made the woman, and he said, this is going to be your companion. You see this? It's the same picture, the same parallel. After we finish Genesis and Revelation, and it's not by accident, I believe, that we study both on Wednesdays, I will give you parallels of Genesis and Revelation. Genesis and Revelation. In fact, even from chapter 1, Genesis chapter 1 and Revelation. Genesis 2 and 3 up to 11 and Revelation. Genesis, Revelation, Old Testament, New Testament. And you'll see the parallels are happening exactly. Amen. Even the numbers, not by accident. Remember just a few numbers. 40, 100, 400, 10. How many years were the Israelites, the Jewish people, were in captivity, the Babylonian captivity? How many years? 70 years. Why? Because they broke Ten Commandments times seven, 70 years exactly. God moves very punctually. And in fact, mathematicians studied the numbers, and it's amazing how they were put there. I mean, from 40 plus different human authors on the human side, it is God inspired, but on the human side, can you see that? Praise the Lord. So powerful. It's amazing how God moves. I believe the church was birthed when blood and water came out from his side. And he washed us. Acts of the Apostles 20, verse 28. He purchased his church with his blood. And the church was birthed on the cross, not on the day of Pentecost. That's the continuation. That's the infilling of the church. That's why you can say the church and the Lord Jesus are one. Amen? We have a couple here right in front of us. They are one in Christ. If you're married with your wife, you're one. God refuses to see you as single. He blesses you as a unit. Amen. So praise the Lord for these divine truths. And the Bible says in the verse we read, which have forsaken, 2 Peter 2:15, which have forsaken the right way and are gone astray, following the way of Balaam, the son of Bosor, who loved the wages of unrighteousness. So Balaam loved the wages of unrighteousness. The Bible interprets the Bible. I promised you, the Lord allowing, we'll do a special study just for Balaam to see if he was a real prophet or not. But I will leave that for next time. But here you have just one key of the many about the life of Balaam, who was not an Israelite. But I will explain to you many other things on another time, like the fact that five different tribes entered into Samaria and they spoiled the people. They confused the people. And they dispersed the people because they didn't keep the way of the Lord. And to this day, you cannot trace the northern kingdom of Israel and only the Jews. That's why they are called the Jews, because the Jews are the Yehudim, the Jewish people. So Israel now is connected only with Judah. The tribe of Judah, that the Levites and Benjamin, the two tribes, were together in the south kingdom. But if you stick to the Lord, he will stick to you. If you cleave to the Lord, he will cleave to you. 10 tribes are dispersed. They intermingled with the nations. They lost their language. They lost their covenant. They lost their DNA amongst many other people. And they're dispersed. But the Jewish people, the Yehudim, the Levites, the Benjamin tribe, you can trace till today. And they are found in India, found in Ethiopia, and found in many other places. So we are not to be moved away by anybody. You're not to be uprooted and gone astray because somebody fell. Somebody loved the wages of unrighteousness. we love the wages of the Lord. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. The Son of Man came to give life and give it abundantly. John 10:10. Now let's move to another scripture. Nehemiah chapter 8. In verse 5. Nehemiah chapter 8 verse 5. And Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people, for he was above all the people. And when he opened it, all the people stood up. If you want to underline or highlight a scripture about honoring the word of God, and I have scriptures to give you, we are supposed to praise the word of God. I have scriptures to give you. And this is not our subject now, but if God is the only one that accepts, receives worship, and we are to worship the word of God, so we don't deal with a book, we deal with God himself. So do you see now the component of being one that makes us one with God? The church was named the way. So you cannot separate God from his church. Christ from you. He lives in me. So if we give him the glory and give ourselves available to him and empty ourselves and give God the glory, you are one with God. They will see you and they will see God. They will see you and they will see the word, that the word is alive in you. All the people stood up, for he was above all the people. And when he opened it, all the people stood up. Wow. I gave you two clues about the last days. And one had to do with the phrase in Joel 2:28, by analyzing a phrase in the original Hebrew Masoretic text, King James Bible. And the Masoretic text, the underlined Hebrew text, the Bible, it says, Acharit Hayamim, about the last days, describing the last days, and it means the two polarized situations that we will witness in the last days. Not only the evil, but the good one also. Two sides. Let the holy be holier. Let the one who is polluted be more polluted. And the word Shana. Why do I insist on these words? Because I'm going to expand later on, since time is up and we are ready for the Lord's Supper. But these two situations are witnessed by us right now as we see it happening before our eyes. Remember, signs are for the world to see, not for you. You're to be one of the signs that the world is supposed to see. That's why you don't look for signs. You are one. You're supposed to be one. If we carry the power of God, if we cleave unto the Lord and we are one spirit, if we have been birthed by Jesus Christ our Lord on the cross, as Eve came out of the first Adam, the church was birthed out of the last Adam. God is restoring everything back. So there is a parallel between Adam and Eve and the last Adam, Jesus Christ, and the church, who are one. And may everyone see the oneness we have with the Lord Jesus. And as the Lord Jesus prayed in John 17, Father, now I pray, make them one as we are one. That's the true unity of the Spirit. We are first so much united with Christ in one that unity between us takes place automatically. We are drawn together. We are drawn together to praise the Lord. We are drawn together to hear the word of God. We are drawn together to serve Him to the end of our lives.